God our Father, and the Lord Jesus Christ. After this, that's how the gospel reading begins. And those words call to mind everything that came before. What came before was persecution. In John chapter 5, Jesus healed a man, and John notes, and the reason the Jews were persecuting was this, because he was doing these things on the Sabbath. To which Jesus said, "My Father is working until now, and I am working." And for that reason, the Jews sought to kill him all the more, because not only was he breaking the Sabbath, he was even calling God his own Father, making himself equal with God. But Jesus wasn't the only one persecuted right before the feeding of the 5,000. In Matthew chapter 14, we learn that John the Baptist had just been beheaded. Now when Jesus heard of this, he withdrew from there in a boat to a desolate place by himself. And thence follows the miraculous feeding. But persecution wasn't the only reason Jesus withdrew. The 12 apostles had just returned from preaching repentance, casting out demons, healing the sick. Jesus says to them, "Come away by yourselves to a desolate place and rest a while." For many were coming and going, and they had no leisure even to eat. The apostles were weary and needed refreshment. But they weren't the only ones weary and in need of refreshment. Some of the people heard that Jesus and the apostles were departing, and they followed them. Some even arrived to the desolate place before they did. It says in Mark chapter 6, when Jesus went ashore, he saw a great crowd, and he had compassion on them, because they were like sheep without a shepherd. And he began to teach them many things. Their souls were in distress, and Jesus had mercy on them. But their souls weren't the only thing in distress. We learn in Luke chapter 9 that Jesus spoke to them of the kingdom of God and cured those who had need of healing. The people were suffering in their bodies as well as their souls. After this, the reading began, and this includes persecution and weariness and as met with suffering of soul and suffering of body. Everything is wrong with the world. There are enemies of God's people, demons causing trouble, sins needing repenting, anguish of soul, failing bodies. It's the Lord's creation, his world, but it's no longer how he created it to be. It seems we're out of place here, and we long for home. This sentiment is a frequent one among God's people, the longing for home. You can think of Israel during their exile in Babylon. They had inherited the promised land, and the Lord had given them peace on every side. And then they had gone after other gods. The Lord sent to them persistently by his servants the prophets. And the people persistently sinned and would not listen, until the wrath of the Lord rose against his people, until there was no remedy. Then came the exile. Babylon arrived and ransacked the city, burned Jerusalem to the ground. They took many of the Israelites away. In a foreign country, the Israelites lamented. "By the waters of Babylon, there we sat down and wept when we remembered Zion." They had witnessed the destruction of their homes, slaughter of family and friends. They felt in their bodies the pains inflicted on them by their oppressors. They knew persecution. They knew physical suffering. They knew that longing for home. But perhaps the hardest to bear was the suffering in the soul. Whatever else they suffered, they still had to confess, "We have brought this on ourselves." So also, when we consider our longing for paradise, we have to admit we had paradise, and we sinned. And now here we sit, by the waters of Babylon, in the haunts of demons, surrounded by enemies, inflicted with all manner of suffering. And we can't just lay it all on Adam. Sure, he ate the fruit, but we have participated in his sin. And whatever we've suffered in this world, we deserve 1,000 times more of it. And yet the Lord comforts his people in Babylon. He speaks to us who were like sheep without a shepherd through the prophet Ezekiel, chapter 34. Behold, I myself will search for my sheep and will seek them out. As a shepherd seeks out his flock when he is among his sheep that have been scattered, so will I seek out my sheep. And I will rescue them from all places where they have been scattered on a day of clouds and thick darkness. And I will bring them out from the peoples and gather them from the countries and will bring them into their own land. And I will feed them on the mountains of Israel, by the ravines, and in all the inhabited places of the country. I will feed them with good pasture, and on the mountain heights of Israel shall be their grazing land. There they shall lie down in good grazing land, and on rich pasture they shall feed on the mountains of Israel. I myself will be the shepherd of my sheep, and I myself will make them lie down, declares the Lord God. Now this prophecy was fulfilled in part when the Persians took over Babylon, and King Cyrus allowed the Israelites to return back to the land of Israel. And yet, 5.5 centuries after their return, at the time of Christ, God's people still remain scattered here, there, and everywhere over the face of the earth. God's scattered people were called the dispersion. And they still had that longing for home. Ezekiel's prophecy had only been fulfilled in part. It awaited its greater fulfillment. And in the feeding of the 5,000, Jesus shows us what that prophecy is all about. There are many connections between Ezekiel's prophecy and the feeding of the 5,000. In Ezekiel chapter 34, the Lord mentions the mountains of Israel, the mountain heights of Israel. And then in John chapter 6, Jesus went up on the mountain. In Ezekiel, the Lord promised, I will rescue them from all the places where they have been scattered on a day of clouds and thick darkness. And then in John we hear the Passover, feast of the Jews, was near. It calls to mind that great rescue that the Lord accomplished in bringing his people out of the land of Egypt. And it prepares us for another great act of rescue. In Ezekiel, the Lord says, they shall lie down. And I myself will make them lie down. And then in John, Jesus says, have the people lie down. In Ezekiel, the Lord mentions good grazing land and rich pasture. And then in John, we hear what appears to be a random comment, but is very purposefully included. There was much grass in the place. Finally, in Ezekiel, the Lord promises, I will bring them out from the peoples and gather them from the countries, and will bring them into their own land. And in John, Jesus says after the feeding, gather up the leftover fragments that nothing may be lost. And the disciples filled 12 baskets, calling to mind the 12 tribes of Israel. After all, what does anyone care about leftover bread? The Lord is concerned about the ingathering of his people. And so we see that the prophecy in Ezekiel 34 was somewhat fulfilled by Cyrus the Great, was fulfilled even more at the feeding of the 5,000. And yet, even the feeding of the 5,000 did not involve all of God's people. And those who were involved were dispersed right back to their homes afterwards. Ezekiel's prophecy still awaited its complete fulfillment. And in the feeding of the 5,000, we have more than a hint of what that fulfillment would be. The feeding of the 5,000 leaves us expecting another Passover, another loaf, another miraculous feeding. Jesus must again take bread and give thanks and break it and distribute it. And that's exactly what happened. After that last supper, the Lord's supper, Jesus went out to gather and rescue his sheep. "I am the good shepherd," Jesus says in John chapter 10. "The good shepherd lays down his life for the sheep." He laid down his life by being lifted up on the cross. And Jesus promised in John chapter 12, "I, when I am lifted up from the earth, will draw all people to myself." Thus, bearing our illnesses and sins, bearing the enmity of the enemy, bearing our exile outside the city walls, bearing all our suffering of body and soul, Jesus gathered us and rescued us by dying for us. But how do the people of God gather as one around the death of Jesus? The crucifixion happened back then. It's an event fixed in time, and that time is not our time, nor the time of the great majority of the church. How does Jesus gather us around his death, and where does he gather? Jesus gathers his people in the sacrament of the altar, the holy supper of his body and blood. As it says in 1 Corinthians chapter 10, the bread that we break, is it not a participation in the body of Christ? Because there is one bread, we who are many are one body, for we all partake of the one bread. The body of Christ that we receive at the altar this morning is the same body of Christ received at Prince of Peace and Coral, of St. Paul in Iowa City, Trinity in Cedar Rapids, our sister congregations throughout the state, the country, the world. It is the same body of Christ that our forefathers received, and their fathers before them. In this sacrament of the altar, Jesus gathers his entire church to himself, not by removing us from time and space, but by bringing the food of his cross to every time and every space. And thus, when Jesus comes to us, he brings heavenly, eternal things, and in fact brings heaven and eternity itself. We'll confess this in just a few minutes in the liturgy, that we stand before the altar and sing with angels and archangels and all the company of heaven. This theme reminds me of one of the earliest communion prayers that the church has, dating back to the first century. As this piece of bread was scattered over the hills, and then was brought back together and made one, so let your church be brought together from the ends of the earth into your kingdom. And this prayer didn't just look for its answer at the last day. It looked for the answer in the sacrament itself. Well, this is all very interesting, but what's the point? First, we can certainly identify with God's wandering and sojourning people. We have been scattered in a world of sickness, death, sin, devils, enemies, suffering, pains of all kinds, and we are not guiltless. We have deserved to be scattered. The Apostle Peter begins his first letter with these words, "To those who are elect exiles of the dispersion." Similarly, the Apostle James writes to the church, "To the 12 tribes in the dispersion, greetings." But the real point, the point of Ezekiel's prophecy, the point of the feeding of the 5,000, the real point is that Jesus has come to his homesick people and has gathered them to himself. At the hour of death, or on the last day, whichever comes first, Jesus will bring us to our homeland. And until then, in the sacrament of the altar, Jesus brings our homeland to us. Here is hope in persecution. Here is rest for the weary. Here is freedom from the devil. Here is the forgiveness of sins. Here is relief from every anguish of body and soul. Here is the mountain of the Lord. Here are the mountain heights of Israel. Here is the Passover. Here is the rescue from a foreign land. Here is the feasting. Here is the good grazing land and the rich pasture. Here is the ingathering of God's people. Here is home. Peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus.